Well, he is the undisputed leader of talkback radio, but his influence spreads much further than just the airwaves. When Alan Jones speaks, our politicians listen. And in this exclusive interview with Angela Bishop, the man who rules radio opens up on his health battles and his rivals.
For almost 30 years, it's been the way most Sydney radio listeners wake up, listening to the Alan Jones radio show. He's been a steady voice through the reigns of 7 Prime Ministers, 10 New South Wales Premiers, and he's won an incredible 205 radio surveys.
Just means I've been around for too long.
Didn't you tell me last time we caught up that you're contracted till, I think it was 2020? 2030?
I think they think I'm there till the grave is. Whether I make it to the grave, that's a good question.
Part of that success lays in his pursuit of holding those in power to account, including his own bosses. I noticed you had a bit of a dig at your owners, Fairfax, for their reportage of the radio ratings.
We're all a bit tired of this. I, for one, I don't pump up my own tyres, and nor does the radio station. But if you're going to present radio ratings and stories, you better be right about it. They do happen to be our partner, could you believe? So they promote everybody else, and you'd swear that Radio 2GB or Macquarie Radio were marginalised players in all of this, as opposed to having one, I don't know, the station's one, well, over 100 surveys in a row. If that's supposed to be a journal of truth, well, then practice the journal of truth. If there's an agenda, state what the agenda is. Now, I'll give you an exclusive story, because my understanding is that a major media player in this country wants to approach Fairfax with a view to buying the outfit or parts of it. This is a serious issue if shareholders are not told the truth about all the matters in relation to the company where they've invested their money.
This prospective buyer, is it someone we've all heard of?
Yes.
Can you tell me who it is?
Well, I just told you, they're a major player.
He has a legendary work ethic. He personally replies to every letter he receives, and he famously gets by on just a few hours sleep a day, something his doctors aren't too happy about. You've had some health concerns, and some of them have been pretty big concerns.
Yes, I saw the exit door. Whatever was there, I don't know. I mean,
did you see anything?
No, it was quite strange, really. This wasn't in relation to, I had 5 operations. Well, I had the big operation on my back, and then that the consequence of that was tremendous nerve pain, so I had this, what I called amputational pain in my arms. I just wanted them chopped off. The pain was unbelievable. So I had 3 operations on my neck, and then I contracted this E. coli virus, which kills people. And that was when I was in pretty desperate straits and there was no pulse. So we're not out of the woods yet, but you know, I'm improving every day, and that's the main thing. I mean, my walking has been the problem because my left quad atrophied. So in other words, it sort of weakened and narrowed, and that made walking difficult, but I chucked the stick away about a couple of weeks ago. I'm having a go.
Still doing your Pilates?
Yeah, I do the Pilates. Yeah, it's part of the rehab. Yeah,
it's really good, isn't it?
I tried it. I would never have gone into a Pilates studio ever in my life, and now I'd swear by it.
There is a reason he has the title of the most influential voice in the land. He speaks, and politicians listen. His views and opinions have the power to change policy and shape elections, including the upcoming postal plebiscite.
There are people who are adherents to traditional marriage, man and woman. They've got reasons for that. They're entitled to respect for that view. There are others who simply say, look, marriage surely can be extended to same-sex couples. The world's not going to fall in. Look, my own view is simple in all of this. I think that love is a very elusive thing. Many people think they've found it, and then they lose it, which is a great sadness, and it causes a lot of unhappiness in families. If 2 people can find love, fair dinkum, authentic love, surely to God they shouldn't have to be justifying themselves. I mean, that's the concern I have here, and that's why I'll be voting yes.
Whereas most people settle for one career, Alan has done it all. Broadcaster, political speechwriter, sports coach, and school teacher. And over the years, TV. When you first had your own show, it was with us, it was on Network 10, and I was one of your team, I was one of your reporters on Alan Jones Live. Looking back, that sort of program you did then, which was 1994, was it ahead of its time?
Miles ahead.
Yeah, looking back on it now, what do you think?
I thought the weakness of the program was that it was half an hour or something, which was just stupid, but it was in fact talkback television. And quite strangely, I mean, when I coached the Wallabies in New Zealand in 1986, they had talkback TV. We still don't have that here now. We have, you know, panellists.
And the technology would be easier now.
Technology would be easy. And I thought it was a very revolutionary thing, but in a short cycle, I think we did a 10-week cycle, and then at the end of 10 weeks, they said, no, the ratings are not good enough. And it took much longer than that for it to bite. I said the same thing about this show. You know, here you are now celebrating. Congratulations to everyone. 1,000 episodes of the show, but at the beginning, oh, this won't work. People are quick to write you off, and it's not going to happen overnight. And I thought the 10-week cycle was too short. But that apart, it was the format, the talkback thing, that was, I think, the issue, and we still don't have it.
For years, stories of fighting between Alan and John Laws have filled tabloid papers. They were colleagues at 2UE, but often seen as rivals.
Where are you two at? Do you ever chat? Do you ever catch up? Are you on friendly terms?
Oh, I don't see him. I wouldn't say we were never unfriendly. I mean, obviously, there is this sort of competitive thing. But I think that, again, the media made more of that than it was.
Well, we love a few.
That's right. And, you know, he wasn't averse to sort of putting a bit of fuel on the fire from time to time. But look, John Laws is, an iconic figure in the world of broadcasting. I mean, Laws is a pioneer, a legend. Very, very significant career that he's had. You can't in any way detract from it or dilute the impact of it, and he deserves credit for that, and I hope he's given credit for that while he's alive. We tend to say all these lovely things about people when they die. I mean, I think we should say things about them when they're alive. John Laws' contribution to broadcasting in this country has almost been without peer.
Do you think someone like Carl Sandilands could make the transition from FM radio and everything that he does now into talkback when he grows up, if you like, for want of a better term?
I mean, I think Kyle Sandilands has ability. He knows how to handle a microphone, and he's got views and opinions and so on. Obviously, he's got a particular audience, and there's a particular format that he uses, and this particular content that appeals to that format. But no, he's a genuine radio person, Kyle Sandilands, so I think he would succeed in any format. Obviously, you do have to have a greater breadth of issues. You can't be sort of narrow in
less
your...
Less Kardashians, more Korea?
Yes.
Sort of thing?
That's right. Well, quite. No, I have no doubt he would succeed in any format that he applied himself to.
Speaking of the other people in the radio world, who is the next you in the next generation?
Well, most probably sort of destroy them if I mention them. You know, that's the nature of things, isn't it? We've got them at 2GB. There's a young man who precedes me, Midnight to Dawn, very young. I think he's absolutely outstanding, by the name of Michael McLaren. I think he's outstanding, and I think he could do my program tomorrow, Michael McLaren. Management most probably don't think that, but I'm not too sure how much management in these things know about radio. You know, that's the point.
Really?
Well, you know what I mean. I mean, you've got to be behind a microphone to know whether this works or not. There are plenty of buses pulling up at the station. They've got to be given opportunity.
Any women?
The women primarily, that's a very good question. I don't know why, but the women primarily migrate to the newsroom. They're sleuths. And so we've got a lot of very, well, I think, well, there you are. I think we've got the best newsreader in the country.
Why do you think no women have really made it into that talkback sphere? What is it?
I just don't know, because women are successful everywhere they want to be. So I can only assume it's because they don't want that. They choose other roles in the media.
Love him or loathe him, there will never be another Alan Jones. Someone with not only a dedication to broadcasting, but as a voice for many.
You do a lot of charity work, which I have always admired about you. Do you consider it a duty?
Yes, I do. I do. I think that, in all of these things, I'm rather proud of the fact I've never charged for anything I've done, and nor have I charged for anything I've done in sport, because I think that we've received a lot, and you do have to try to give back. You've got to practice what you preach. I'm a great one for being disciplined and pulling your weight and make sure you do your job and accept the responsibility you've got, and I've got to lead and do that, and that's what I do.